Good morning, everyone. Please confirm if my voice is clear to you all and my screen is visible so that we can move.
Yes,
we are audible.
Yes.
Thanks a lot for the confirmation, guys. Okay, so good morning, everyone. Myself, Rupesh, I'm the host for today's webinar, which is Microsoft Compliance Solution, Learn to Stay Productive, SA900 Certification. So we'll start with the introduction about today's session. Before moving ahead into our webinar, let's have a small introduction about today's one of the event sponsor, that is Synergetics. So Synergetics is the India's one of a kind corporate learning solution company, which helps any industry to get their relevant technological solution and helps to be on top of the competition. We are not only restricted to group trainings, but also our Microsoft certification training help every individual professional to succeed in the competitive world. Here are some of the master solutions offered by Synergetics, which are onboarding, rescaling solution, certification plus add-on, cloud adoption, architecting, practice playbook, latest technology training, emerging technology training. So today's webinar is organized by ATC community and sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft. Our ATC community is open to all the people who are interested in Microsoft cloud technologies. You just need to follow our meetup groups, which are as follows, like emerging technology community, which is the common community for people, all the tech people, Azure Tech Community Pune for the Pune people, Surat Emerging Technology Community for the people from Gujarat, Azure Tech Community Nagpur from the Nagpur for Nagpurkers, Artificial Intelligence AI and Microsoft Platform. So professionals who are interested in artificial intelligence technology, they can follow this group, follow this community. All you have to do is just install an Meetup application in your phone, and you can search this communities and you can join us, so that you will be updated about our future events, webinar, meetups within your cities. So it will be updated to you. Please do that. Let's move ahead. So this is our code of conduct for the day. Please take a note that you cannot take the screenshot and you cannot do the screen recording. So the recording will be shared on our YouTube channel. So for that, you have to follow our, you have to subscribe to our YouTube channel, official YouTube channel. We'll be sharing the link in the chat box. So do check that. So today, I want to share an important message with you all. Recently, there was an incident happened during a webinar. There was an attendee who's also an employee of a very reputed company, had contacted some of our other attendees from the webinar and offered a job options. Please take a note that we have already blacklisted him, and anything that is violating our policies will be facing strict legal actions. I will request you all to join these sessions with a learning purpose, and please do not make such activities which are unprofessional. So please make a note of this. So let's move ahead. So our agenda for the session, this session focuses on understanding compliance options. And our session takeaways are, participants attending this session will be able to understand Azure security certification topics and focus on compliance solution within Microsoft Azure platform. So our today's speaker for the webinar is Mr. Om Prakash Pandey. Om Prakash sir is highly experienced Microsoft certified trainer with decades of rich experience in technical learning and implementation consultations across India and the globe. His teaching experience spans across more than 50,000 students and 200 expertise enterprises around the world. So currently he's working with Synergetics as an AVP of our delivery department. Now you can grow professionally by adding the latest technology skills with Microsoft various certifications. You can enroll for any of these trainings program with Synergetics, where you will experiencing live interactive session with the best industry MCTs. Trust us and we'll deliver the best. So our course calendar for the month is here. So anyone who's interested in any of this training topics, you can see it on the screen. You can just contact me. We'll be sharing my number. You can save it. You can even WhatsApp me. And you can inquire over that number. So I'll share the details. So this is our webinar calendar for the year. Our next webinar that is happening for emerging technology from the emerging technology webinar series. Topic is Jakarta EE9 specifications for NoSQL interactions and designing enterprise web services. It is based on Java technology, happening on 21st of August in the morning, 10 a.m. to 12 noon. You can register for this webinar. We'll be sharing the registration link in the chat box. Again, the next certification webinar will be happening on 4th of September. The topic will be DP900 certification. So that is happening in the afternoon. You can also enroll for this, register for this. We'll be sharing the link for the same. Special announcement for the day. Firstly, your feedbacks are very important to us, guys. So please do share the feedbacks at the end of the session. We do share the feedback form link. So click that link and fill out your feedback. Based on those feedbacks which are submitted, we are going to select 5 lucky winners who are going to win the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers. So do not miss this chance and do share your valuable feedbacks to us. So now I would like to hand over mic to Om Prakash, sir. So you can continue from here.
Thanks, Rupesh.
Thanks a lot, sir.
And good morning once again. I hope I'm audible and my screen is visible to you all.
Sure, is your voice is quite low.
Your voice is very low.
Okay, just give me a moment. Let me rejoin again. Maybe that should help.
Okay.
Is it better now?
Yeah,
it is much better.
Okay.
Yeah.
So let's proceed ahead. So as far as Rupesh and my team, Rupesh and Manish are concerned, they'll be posting a lot of important details on the chat window. So keep an eye on that. While you all are understanding their core details over here. So first thing, before we get into details of this topic, you'll see there are different set of streams which Microsoft has been working on and series of certifications in that area. One of the new streams that Microsoft has released recently is security and compliance stream. So before I proceed ahead, I would want you all to take a look at this diagram over here. Or this link, I would say. So if you look at the number of roles, whether it is identity and access administration, information protection, risk practitioner, right? Whether you look at a role of security engineer, security operations analyst, right? So this covers the major spectrum of security solutions, security roles that we have within any given organization. At times, when you look at large enterprises, they will have a specific teams which will be targeting or focusing these areas. For small mid-sized organization, there could be a certain set of individuals who would be performing more than one roles. In a smaller organization, there would be a single person or an IT team would be already given these responsibilities, right? But yes, these are specific roles which exist in organizations today. If you look at the relevant exams targeted towards them, you have SC200, which is Security Operations Analyst, SC300 for Azure Active Directory deep dive focus over there using Identity and Access Administration. For Information Rights Management, you have SC400 and all the solutions which is relevant for information protection on Microsoft 365. And Azure as well. Then you have your standard exam within which is targeted hardcore towards Azure, which is AZ 500. Now for all these four papers, one of the foundational aspects that you'll see is SC900. Just to make sure everybody doesn't feel that this is a picture which I have put up over here. It's actually a link. I'm sharing this link on the chat window as well, so you all can take a look at it. As far as SC900 is concerned, I was really waiting a long time for this paper. The reason being, there are, as I'm doing trainings for Microsoft courses, Microsoft 365, Office 365 courses, and also I do trainings for Azure security. So most of them are common cross-cutting concerns, which I realized during the sessions. But there was no specific certification for it. I'm not sure how many of you are aware about Microsoft 365. There, recently, say around two and a half years, Microsoft has developed a complete security and compliance center where you have security score, where you have compliance score. You can check for those values over there. See, on a similar lines, you have Azure Security Center as well. So there are certain set of elements which are common in both these areas, right? And security as a role is emerging and it is being very, very prominent in market today. I'm not saying it was not there earlier, but earlier people, security team was focusing in terms of on-prem environment. With all these solutions moving on to cloud, moving on to SaaS services like Office 365, people have to start looking at security in much more dedicated manner, much more focused manner. And keeping that context in mind, we have these series of certifications. Laying down the foundations of that, you have number of courses, which are online courses given by Microsoft. Along with that, there is offline courses also shared by Microsoft, so that various team members do not just get the conceptual knowledge, but should also have expertise in terms of implementing these solutions, right? So here you all can go through these modules by going to the Microsoft learning path that will help you. Apart from this, what Manish and Rupesh, along with our delivery professionals who are certified on these papers, what they do is we help individuals get their dreams come true, being a security solution engineer. But the starting point over here would be laying down the foundations using SC900. So here, if you look at the core principles which are being discussed, security, compliance, identity. Now, once it comes to end users, for end users, all of this may seem to be a single term. May just seem to be a set of terms being used. But if it is being seen by a security solution engineer, for them, they would know that each of these terms being mentioned has a large amount of implementation that has to be done behind the scenes. Right? And we will have to take care of these areas. We'll have to perform the needed steps for making sure all these kind of solutions are in place so that we can avoid any kind of problems, avoid any kind of issues or mistakes which can happen. So if you see, everyone, please keep yourself on mute. Thank you. So if you look at what I was mentioning about in terms of not just conceptual knowledge, but also implementation, here you see there are a number of labs that we'll be doing during the sessions. There are certain set of demos that we will showcase during the session so that you all get a practical and hands-on expertise with each of these members. Like I was mentioning about, there are plenty of details in terms of Microsoft 365, Azure environment, where I will showcase all these solutions during the session. And some of you all who have been security enthusiasts, they would be able to understand what is the significance of each of these members. What is the significance of privileged identity management? What is the significance of conditional access? And the major focus over here is on Azure Active Directory, security solutions given by Microsoft, within Azure and within Office 365. Okay. Keeping this context in mind, let's proceed ahead. And let's look at the first module over here, which is understanding the core concepts of security, compliance, and identity. Now, many a times, any enterprise or even mid-size or small organizations, they have a wrong notion or wrong understanding of things at back of their mind, saying that if we have purchased a cloud solution, if we have got a cloud subscription with us, we have uploaded or created our infrastructure on cloud platform, we are by default secure. Everything else becomes the responsibility of the vendor. Because the salespeople told me about that, some of the pre-sales engineers also mentioned about similar kind of things. I have read on the YouTube videos, seen number of documents, right? There are a lot of things which are not clarified to you. Maybe we have not asked those kind of questions, but the fact of the matter is something else. Now, what is it? How much of this security is taken care by the vendor versus how much of security options we will have to fine tune or provide as part of our solution that we are creating. So as I go ahead, I will discuss about each of these things. Let's go to the first lesson over here. And if you look at any of your Microsoft solutions or any other cloud solutions, everyone has to work with a zero trust model. Correct? And the second thing which I was mentioning about is shared responsibility model. Now, what are these two things all about? We'll get into details of this as we proceed ahead. As far as security options are concerned, security threats are concerned, what are those and how do we protect our environment from such kind of challenges? What is significance of encryption, hashing, and then we'll discuss about cloud adoption framework. Right, so this will be the core areas of discussion as part of our today's session. And I'm pretty sure this should give you a clear cut guidance in terms of why security is important, and especially in terms of cloud, what are the options that I have as an individual so that I can leverage upon these features. I know what are my roles and responsibilities, and I can work in a structured manner towards it. Starting off with the first slide over here, where it very clearly says that everybody should look at a zero trust methodology. What is the meaning of zero trust? Zero trust basically means don't trust anybody. So my team, Rupesh, Manish, my other folks that I have, I cannot assume that when they are logging in from home, when they are logging in using their user ID and password, it is the same person who I know. For the system, it is just an identity. It could be Manish, or it could be his kid or his daughter at home, right? Some other friend in his close vicinity who has sneaked or seen his username password sometime. That could be the person who is logging in. How do we know that? Right? And as far as I know Manish, he will not get into the finance department or finance. He will not try accessing the finance details. Why is he doing today? Correct? Why is he trying to access some other information which is not part of his role? Right? So any information, now that you can't wait for that to happen. I can't wait for Manish to go and try and access those things. I'll have to make sure as a security administrator, I create my system in such a way that even if it is Manish or Rupesh or Om Prakash, we should have our own predefined roles. We should have a specific access to our contents itself. So depending upon whatever is my role within the organization, say for example, like Rupesh rightly mentioned, I head the delivery team. So whatever learning materials are concerned, learning resources are concerned, customer details are concerned, that information I should be allowed to access. And that too, with right privileges, I may have read permissions, write permissions, right? So with right permissions, I should be allowed to access those contents.
Om Prakash, sorry for interrupting you. Your voice is very low. Could you close to your mic or speak loudly, something?
Not possible. I am closest to the mic. I'll try to re-log in once again because I did that earlier and I got a feedback saying that the voice is clear.
Om Prakash, I think you are audible, properly audible. Om Prakash.
It is audible only, Om Prakash, for me also.
Yeah, for me also. It's a good.
Thank you, everyone. My request is if you can increase the volume at your end, maybe that helps. Sorry for the inconvenience. Let's proceed ahead. So I was mentioning about zero trust model. Zero trust model means I am preparing on day one, point one, saying that there will be a security breach. I am pretty confident on that. So if that security breach happens, what are the steps I'm supposed to take? Right? So I'm not saying it's a most pessimistic kind of attitude, but that's what it is. If I don't keep that attitude or if I don't keep that mindset, I will not be playing my role as a security engineer effectively. So very simple and straightforward. Day one, when the entire environment is being set up, it can be hacked, it can be breached, my data can be stolen, right? That is the kind of mindset I begin with. And that is the core foundations of zero trust methodology or zero trust model. So when we are looking at this zero trust methodology, I will first of all apply your 80-20 principle. 20% information is the most critical one. Like I gave an example of finance and I gave an example of why would Manish try to access the finance information, right? Now you'll have to identify that what is the 20% within the customer's environment. Start protecting that, because if you try for protecting 100%, maybe you don't protect anything. So let's focus on that 20% critical piece. Let's protect that, right? Now that 20% or that targeted areas, targeted modules, targeted information, who should be accessing them? What is the identities that you are mapping to them, right? As far as Manish is concerned, he has been given a device by the organization. He has been given a laptop, he has been given a mobile device. He should be accessing the contents even from the marketing information only using that device, right? So it's not just Manish, it's combination of Manish plus that device, correct? Third step here, if you see, trying to access it via an application. So identity is Manish, @synergetics-india.com. Accessing the organization contents by using a mobile device or a laptop. On that laptop, he may have number of other applications. His kids want to play certain games, so they would have installed some application on that device, Play Store, right? Even there, I have an app. Using that app on that device with that identity, he will be allowed to access some piece of information. Are you getting it? That's the kind of level of thinking. That's the kind of approach that one needs to take whenever we are allowing any kind of critical data to be accessed by an individual, right? And I'm not talking about Manish, who has recently joined. Manish and Rupesh have been working with us from last 15 years. So it's not about who they are. It's not about what is the time they have been as part of our organization. And that is what I mean by zero trust. When I say zero trust, it is, you cannot be subjective. You can't be human saying that, how can a person do like something like this, right? It's not about that. It's about zero trust. You don't trust anybody. And in this kind of virtual world where data is the king, people have been accessing this information from an unsafe Wi-Fi locations or unsafe locations. You'll have to keep all your resources. You have to keep your security solutions at the top. Right? Now, keeping this kind of specifications in mind, we'll have to create our infrastructure accordingly. We'll have to create our networks accordingly. Make sure we open relevant ports for it. Right? Now, how that things would be done? What are the resources available? That will be defined by the underlying environment that you are using. If you're using something like Microsoft 365, which is a SaaS solution, in that scenario, infrastructure and network, you can't control because that's taken care of entirely by the vendor. Whereas if you're looking at Azure-based solutions, there you can look at virtual machines, there you can look at app service plans, functions, function as a service if you're using, right? You can look at network security groups. So what components you'll use to build this environment or build this kind of solution, that will be defined by the underlying infrastructure as well. Correct? So if you look at the core principle here, trust no one, whoever it is, doesn't matter. Verify everything. So I don't know who you are. I would want to make sure that you enter your credentials, use biometrics, use RSA tokens, use every possible mechanism to ensure that it is the same user who he or she is saying that they are. Okay, so be explicit, be very clear. What will be the rules over here? What will be the details that you would want to mention? Another important point that you'll see is least privilege access. And I gave an example saying that if Manish needs to work with marketing resources, he should have all permissions there. Barring that, he should not have permissions, or even if required, he should have minimum permissions wherever needed. So he should have a read permission on some of the delivery material. He can have read permission on some kind of final yearly reports that he should be accessing. He will not have write permissions there. That's what is referred as least privilege access. And third and the most important one, which I have been talking about, is you assume that this data can be breached. This data can be hacked. Now, if that data is important for me, what are the measures which I'm taking to protect it? So Rupesh rightly mentioned about why not to take screen recordings or why not to capture these, because as a training organization, this is what is the most important element for us. This is the kind of service that we are providing. This is what makes us unique within the industry, right? Making sure we take up latest technologies, we go to the audiences with those latest technologies, saying that, boss, this is what we offer. And that's our uniqueness that we have, right? And we want to make sure that we protect from any kind of breach. We want to make sure we protect from unwanted audience. Sorry, some conversation, but not understandable. Okay, please keep yourself on mute. Right, so this is the most important pillars that I discussed over here as part of how this will be implemented on a day-to-day basis. So once you look at identities, identities may not be just users, it could be services, it could be devices, right? I mentioned about that. Once it comes to devices, Microsoft provides something called as endpoint protection. And using these endpoint protection solutions, you can also ensure that you have secured your devices here, right? On that particular device, what is the application you want to install? Your data should be labeled correctly. There has to be a right kind of meta information for it, right? So if you are searching these resources, searching this content, you should be able to find out that information faster. Like I said, this information is financial information. This information is financial, but it is a report which is being publicly accessible with everyone. So if you have any such specifics, the the simplicity of that, or the way how you can make it available, way how you can classify it, is by putting right kind of meta information. Apart from this, any data that you are creating should be encrypted. You should have right kind of encryption keys over here. Whether you want to use your self-managed keys, or you want Microsoft to provide you with some such keys by using resources called as Key Vault. So using a Key Vault service, I'm not sure how many of you have worked with it earlier. With Key Vault as a service, you can store your earlier keys. You can also go ahead and create a new key over here, which can be set as an expiry date, saying that after this particular date, this key will become invalid. Right? So you can regenerate those keys. So this is a complete infrastructure, complete services on Microsoft platform, which has ensured that day in, day out concerns of people in context of security gets answered over here. And some of these things can be done by an organization which has been serving enterprises from more than 4 decades. They know what enterprises need. They know what is the significance of security. In terms of infrastructure, I already mentioned about the solutions. Earlier, in context of on-premises, people would think that on-premises is something which is a much secured environment, right? As compared to cloud-based. Now, why is that? I don't understand that part. So, in number of my sessions, I have asked a simple question, that how do you think cloud is not secured and on-premises is secured? They say cloud is accessible via a web URL. Okay. Even on-premises, you can create a FTP, SMTP. You can open those ports. You can host a web application. You can host a RESTful service and make that accessible via web URL. As far as cloud is concerned, do we access it using HTTPS? That's right. Do we access it via RESTful endpoints? But anybody who connects to that service has to mention the user ID and password, and you can have multi-factor authentication with that. So what makes cloud not secured? And simple conclusion that we came up after a lot of discussion and debates is, the most secure system is a system which is not connected with anything. If it is not connected on network, if it is not connected on internet, that's the most secure system. The moment you enable connectivity with that system, there are chances of attack. There are chances of hacking that system. Now, choice is yours. Do you want a non-accessible system, or you want to have a secured and accessible system? So in today's context, if I have something like mainframe, or if I have a large set of machine, but only one person or one individual can access that machine at a given point in time, it has no meaning. So whether it is on-premises, whether it is public cloud, you will have to take up this methodology in mind. You'll have to understand that attacks can happen anytime. So what is your mechanism of protecting this environment? What is your mechanism of ensuring security on this environment? By using number of security solutions, by giving number of options which are available. Okay. So this was a quick understanding of what is this meaning of zero trust model. Share a URL with you all. You can go through it right now. You can go through it later. Video that Microsoft has released for zero trust methodology. You can take a look at that. Let me go to the next section over here, which is defense in depth. I mentioned about some of the aspects in previous discussion about device, identity, application, and how do you protect data with that? Here, let's go to one more level below it. Let's understand the depth over here. And I was trying to mention about how cloud is secured as an environment. So if you look at difference in depth, the first thing which will happen over here is checking for physical security. Okay, you all must have heard about and you all must have read about the documentation released by Microsoft stating how critical the physical security is for them in terms of fencing, in terms of segregation of these resources, right? Having biometrics for people before they enter into the premises, right? So all these things are exclusively taken care. All these things are being protected and mapped by Microsoft themselves. And this is not just about one data center. This is about every data center. Wherever they may have given the management to the local bodies, the specifications, the guidelines are same, whether it is US, whether it is India, whether it is Singapore, or wherever they have their data centers. They have same set of security norms everywhere. Now, once this physical security is being taken care, second aspect, which I already spoke about, is identity and access management. I don't want to repeat that because of the lack of time as well. Third point, which I did not mention about, is perimeter security. So when I say physical security, it also includes the rack servers, right? The machines that we have on those rack machines, which has been configured on those rack servers, right? In terms of perimeter security, here there's a complete provision of DDoS basic, right? Distributed denial of service. Now, being a web application, being a RESTful service, one common thing that a hacker can do is, even if they are not able to extract information, they can generate so many requests that the service becomes unusable. Correct? So using smart algorithms, what Microsoft has done is they will check if these requests are coming from a specific location. If this request is coming from a specific IP address, if this request is being generated in a pace which is not possible for a human being, which means these requests are being generated by your application, which could be a bot or which could be a malicious app, right? So you can check that and can block that request so that other normal requests, they can get fulfilled immediately. Apart from DDoS basic, we can go and specify DDoS standard. DDoS standard will be a higher version. Please be careful, it's a paid service. DDoS basic is free of charge. DDoS standard is a paid service where you get additional protection for your application, right? So you can check for that. In terms of network security, which is on top of it, you can use something like Azure firewalls over here. You can use network security groups over here to enforce and ensure security on the network level. In terms of compute, application, data, on each of these members, you can use network security groups where you can allow certain ports for communication. Correct? Now, if you look at, like I was mentioning earlier, if you have put your solutions on cloud, you cannot safely assume that everything is protected by the vendor. It is also a joint responsibility between the vendor and us. The reason being, there are, once you are putting up your virtual machine and you have opened up all the ports and you get hacked, you cannot blame the vendor for that. It is your responsibility to make sure you open up only those ports which are relevant or required for communication. Right? Like I gave an example of Manish, who's my close friend. So if I allow all the application contents within the organization to be allowed to be accessed by Manish, and he by mistake goes and deletes them, it's not a problem of Office 365 or Microsoft 365. It is my mistake as a security engineer. So I will have to ensure what are the contents or application information which is relevant for him and he should be allowed to access. Correct? So we are looking at application contents. We are ensuring that it is free of any of the security vulnerabilities. As far as data is concerned, here we can deploy some of the solutions in terms of encryption. So again, like I said earlier, even after doing all these stuff, even after putting all these checks and balances in mind, I still feel that data can be breached. Data can still be hacked by somebody. If that happens, what do I do? So if that happens, I have an encryption over here on that data. So anybody who has stolen the data can't decrypt it, because that person does not have the decryption key. I have the decryption key with me. Right? Now, this is what we mean, zero trust model. So identity and access management does not rely that physical security will take care of itself. Perimeter does not depend upon identity and access. Network security doesn't depend upon perimeter. So each layer or each person responsible for each of these layers have to perform their best, has to put in best of their knowledge and effort to make sure it is being secure. Whatever options are available on that particular layer, do that. In terms of three core parameters that you have is confidentiality, integrity, and finally, availability. So whatever we spoke in previous two slides clearly tells you about what is the significance of confidentiality, right? So we have a lot of customer information, their passwords. I already gave example of financial data. So this part I already discussed about. As far as integrity is concerned, I already mentioned about encryption in both the earlier slides, so I do not talk about that here. If you go to the third one, now this is very, very important. When it comes to availability, there's always a challenge when you keep increasing the number of security layers. Is the data becoming inaccessible? Is the data becoming non-accessible to people who are supposed to access it? Right? Like I gave an example of financial data, but it should not happen that finance team itself can't access data. Finance team should be able to access that information. They should be able to create appropriate reports time and again, and that should be much more faster. So availability or accessibility of that information, that cannot be hampered just because you are increasing the security levels. Okay, so that part we have to take care. Once it comes to security, there is always two important aspects here, which I'm sure everybody would be aware about. So first aspect over here is authentication. And second aspect over here is the authorization. So once it comes to availability, you need to make sure you authorize people. You have right authorization to access the content. Again, don't leave the principle of least privileged access or minimum permissions. Don't leave that. But it should be available to people, available to right kind of users. This is the most important slide, I would say, as part of the entire conversation that we are having. Now, as part of this shared responsibility model, let me explode it a bit more so it becomes clearer. Once I go to cloud, everything is taken care of by cloud. No, it doesn't happen that way. There are different set of levels or different places where you have to identify where is your responsibility. Look at the top section. Information and data, how that gets protected, how devices will be secured, which devices you are allowing, which accounts and identities you are allowing to access that information. These things will always be taken care of by the customer. Customer, who's the customer here? We are the customers. We are the ones who are using this platform. We will have to take care of these three things. Okay. So creation of users, whether you are creating single users, whether you are creating bulk users, whether you are creating B2B resources, whether you are creating B2C identities, right? All these things we will have to take care. It is nothing to do with the service provider. Service provider can give you one account, and that is why is that essential. Otherwise, even we can't log in. We in sense, the service owner or the subscription owner also can't log in inside that. So that's one default account or default identity being given. Every other identity you will have to create. Right? You can do that by using your Azure AD Connect. You can synchronize all the users on the directory, Azure Active Directory. That's your choice. But that is our responsibility. Registering the devices, right? Specifying settings for those devices, that has to be taken care of by us. Any kind of information and data management that we are doing, that is completely our responsibility. Who will be accessing which information, which device will be allowed to access that contents, using which application, all those things we will have to configure. That's our responsibility. So if this is what we are doing, what is the vendor doing? What are they charging us for? Okay, so if you go to the next section here, what they charge you for is providing the infrastructure, providing the environment which can handle, which can allow access, allow connectivity. So once you log in as Om Prakash, once you log in as Rupesh, you log in as Manish, you should be given a specific token behind the scene. Using that token, you'll be able to perform your tasks smoothly. That is the core responsibility, and that is what is called as shared responsibility model, where the vendor provides you those services. But one thing which I don't understand is, in IaaS and on-prem, it is completely filled blue box. But here, it is half shaded. What do I mean by this? And why is it being done this way? Anybody who can understand this?
Is it about the shared responsibility?
Okay, anybody else? Anyone else? Okay, no issues.
I think those are the things which is customizable, which Microsoft provides it, and we can plug in the controls to whatever extent you want.
Superb. So once it comes to these shaded boxes that you see here, as far as Azure Active Directory is concerned, which is a primary identity and directory service, it has number of licenses. So you have a free license, you have a Office 365 license, you have a P1 license, you have a P2 license. So depending upon what features you want to implement over here, you'll have to first of all choose the right kind of license. That's the first step. Second step, like very rightly said, you'll have to just choosing a license is not sufficient. You'll have to go ahead and enable those features, tune those features to get the right kind of security, get right kind of performance, get right kind of reports. These kind of things have to be enabled or configured on the environment. That is why it is half shaded. So because this is a shared responsibility, like very rightly said. So between the customer, which is the license the customer is using, and another thing which is important, it's a paid service. These licenses will cost you higher. So you are the one who's supposed to purchase that license, configure it. Like I said, like I gave an example of DDoS. DDoS basic is free, but DDoS standard you'll have to purchase and you have to configure. Okay. In terms of applications, Exchange Online, SharePoint Online, OneDrive, Dell, there are more than 28 pre-existing applications that you have once it comes to your Microsoft 365. Right? And still are bad luck. People are still using a lot of third-party services or third-party applications for the same thing. I'm not saying that's wrong. Using third-party services is not a mistake. But when you are already paying for it, why don't you use that service? And then we have, as a part of Microsoft partner ecosystem, where we can assist you how to use that tool There's so much of documentation, videos which is being there, then what's the problem? Okay, but we'll talk about that in some other session in more details. Let's go ahead. In terms of past solutions, same thing applies here as well. In terms of network controls, so certain things you have to purchase. Certain things, like in context of identity and directory infrastructure, there's licensing model. In case of applications and network controls, these are configurable resources. There are something called as additions. So you have LRS, GRS, RAGRS, right? So you'll have to purchase those kind of components. There'll be an additional charge involved for it, but and you'll have to configure it, right? So what does the infrastructure or what does the vendor charge you for? The vendor charges you for creating a data center, putting up the network in place, having a rack servers, protecting those environments, installing a right kind of operating system on it based on the template selection, having basic network controls for SaaS solutions. This is what the vendor is doing. So depending upon the services being provided, right? But I'm not sure if I understand it correctly. As far as IS is concerned, that at times if you see the IS will have highest cost versus if you look at the SaaS solutions, it will have a much lower cost as compared to IS. With increase in services, the cost should increase. Am I right with that? With increase in services given by the vendor, the cost should increase, but actually it is reverse. SaaS has the lowest cost as compared to IS. IS has a maximum cost. Why is that?
Because IS is especially for you, they designed, and it is shared for other vendors.
Absolutely correct. So once it comes to IS, here what we are saying is we want maximum control. We will provide details of whatever we are looking for. So it's more specific, right? Like very rightly said, it's more specific to the individual or an organization, and they would want to provide their own set of details over here. Vis-a-vis, if you look at a PaaS solution, the amount of control that you have is reduced. You don't control the underlying OS. You don't control the patching and all those things. So you have lesser responsibilities, and it is going ahead with a shared model. There's more and more sharing that you have. So you all must have used Ola, Uber, right? So as far as your private taxi is concerned, your private cab will be charging you maximum, whereas Ola will be charging you lesser than that. Even within Ola, you'll be going for a private cab there for one or two rides. It's up to you. If you're going for a shared cab, then you're going for a SaaS service. Right? So how do you want to use that resource? That's up to you. And the cost will vary depending upon how much control, how much of privacy that you would want for yourself. Let's proceed further. So I hope everybody is clear with shared responsibility model. Now, if you want to get into, specifics of each of these things, which PaaS service, what are the virtual machines available, what are the SaaS services available? Om Prakash, can you give me more details of that? Yes. So Rupesh, Manish, and myself, we are here to help you with understanding more of these details in more of these things in details, but you'll have to help us providing your details, which courses, which solutions you all want to take a look at, right? Again, it could be your growth path that you have defined for yourself, or it could be your application requirements from your organization. So based on that, if you'll give us an opportunity to help you all out, we can definitely do that. And with team of more than 50 trainers with us, it will be our pleasure to helping you out with all the details in terms of SaaS solutions with Microsoft 365, PaaS solutions using Azure AZ 204, where you can go and develop these solutions, or using AZ-104, working with the infrastructure solutions or security solution that we are talking about right now. Correct? Because each of these things, as you'll see in terms of layers, there is more deep dive into each of these areas. There's more elaboration into each of these areas. So if you have to become a solution provider, you need to get into depth of each of these things. So as part of these sessions that we are doing, we are ensuring that we reach out to you, show us the skills that we have, show us the knowledge that we have, and what all things do we cover. And that's what Rupesh was trying to do, and that's what even I'm trying to do using the mechanism of this session. Let's proceed further. Let's go to the next section over here, which is Microsoft Cloud Adoption Framework, which is also very commonly referred as CAF. Right? So as part of your CAF implementation, if you look at the options available here, various organizations are moving towards cloud, and earlier the question whether to go for cloud or not is actually out of the window. Today, if you look at the option here, it's about how do we go about cloud adoption? How soon can we do that? What will be a roadmap for us, for our organization, based on the current workloads, based on type of people that we have, based on the resources that we have, based on the network team that we have and their respective knowledge, right? So what will be the approach towards cloud? Now that entire details is being mentioned over here as part of the life cycle, which is defining a right kind of strategy, defining a complete plan for it, getting the environment ready. Either you adopt cloud completely, you integrate or migrate your resources from on-prem environment here. Even if you have done migration, you would want to innovate, that is moving from IaaS solutions to PaaS solutions, or building new business solution on this platform using the new set of services that we have, right? So this is a complete end-to-end solution given to you by Microsoft, which is called as Cloud Adoption Framework. And I really like this process. The reason being, it is very well documented, lot of information being provided here. I'm sorry, just a moment. I can't resist myself showcasing this complete documentation. And here, if you'll see, guys, there is something called as Azure Architecture Center. Right? Here you can see set of options of choosing these things. Manish and Rupesh always keep saying that, Om Prakash, don't do these things. But I'm pretty sure that seeing this kind of information, people will understand what is architecting, what are the solutions that we offer. This is another set of courses that we offer apart from AZ-204, 104, right? Is how do you build solutions using well-architected framework? And the kind of detailing that Microsoft has done over here for cloud adoption framework. Right? So we'll discuss it in some other session as we go ahead. I'm sure Manish and Rupesh would already have been planning for this. Whenever they plan, I will be there assisting you with that session. Meanwhile, I would need everybody to take 5 minutes over here and go through this video on cloud adoption framework. Let me share this link on the chat window. This is a very quick glimpse of what is cloud adoption framework all about. I'm running the video. I'm not sure if you're able to hear the voice of that.
No voice.
So you all can click on the link which I have shared you on the chat window. I have shared this link with all of you all on the chat window. So whatever I was mentioning about in terms of migration, in terms of innovation, all these points are mentioned over here. Right. So once it comes to identity management, one of the important aspects that it addresses is governance. How different set of individuals can access right set of resources which is required for their day in day out activities. So all this information about security is part of your cloud adoption framework. So see the same diagram which we have seen earlier. It has defined step by step process of why this should happen, how this will happen. I'm sure everybody has been through the video. It's a simple 2-minute video which shows you or tells you what is this cloud adoption framework all about, what are the resources over here. Right, so here if you see under architecture, you'll be able to see reference architectures, well architected framework, which I mentioned about, and you have cloud adoption framework. So all 6 stages that was being mentioned. Right, you'll be able to see all the options over here. What should be the questions being asked, right? Everything you'll find over here on cloud adoption framework. Let's proceed ahead. Okay, so if you look at the common threads over here, well, the most common thread that we see is the data breach, where you have phishing attacks, where user trying to represent as another user, right? Phishing attacks, tech support scams. Go and click on the link. We'll provide you free guidance. We'll provide you free resources. Okay. So in terms of SQL injections, this is part of your, this is very similar to your DDoS attacks, right? But in here, that attack is on the SQL database, where the hacker would want to add things like semicolon, ampersand, or some special characters which will break the communication between your data access layer and your database behind the scene, and it shows the connection string. So once the connection string is being retrieved, the hacker would know what is the database, what is the, whether it is a URL, whether it is an IP address, and they can attack that machine. Right, so such kind of things can happen, and that would result into a data breach. And that's why, if you recall, we mentioned that you, when it, in case of data breach, make sure you have your data encrypted, right? Another thing that you'll see is a dictionary attack, right? Where the hacker attempts to steal the identity. You may have a fake sites or fake web pages saying that this is your new banking page, which has been modified. Please click on it. Type in your user ID and password. And thinking that, yes, this is a new site. It looks changed. It looks better, right? And once we type in our user ID and and password, it says, sorry, could not connect. Please try later. So you would think that, yes, this is a normal process. The server may be down. But what it has done is they have captured your user ID and password. And later stages, they will go and get into your account, deduct money, or perform any kind of malicious activities by using those credentials, right? That's why I said earlier also that when Manish is logging in, I cannot believe he's Manish if he is trying to access a critical information. So I'll say, if you are Manish, please prove your identity by using a multi-factor authentication. I'm sending you an OTP. I have sent you an email on your official email address. Can you please check and tell me what is that ID? So I will be using more than one ways to figure out if it is actually Manish or he is somebody else, right? So those things become a most important part of your security implementation. You'll have things like malware attack. So you have been attacked by, please click on this link so that we can protect your resources. And you would not realize that is actually a way of how you invite viruses or how you get your viruses installed on your environment, right? So there are number of such ways or number of these common threats which are happening on day-to-day basis. Microsoft has complete security lifecycle management team, which keeps verifying for these kind of attacks and keeps upgrading using machine learning algorithms, using artificial intelligence solutions. What they keep doing behind the scene is they keep updating their environment to make sure they can protect their users from such kind of attacks. Some of the common solutions that we discussed earlier is using data encryption. So with data encryption, you can have your algorithms like symmetric encryption, asymmetric encryption. To make it simpler, people who are from security background and who have been working with this, they will understand the purpose of this. Whereas some of them who are new to this environment are enthusiastic about security, but they don't know about symmetric and asymmetric encryption. All your HTTPS or SSL keys that you see, they are all using asymmetric encryption behind the scene. Right? So you have an option of public key, private key token. So when I give you a public key, you revert back with a private key. I will check if that values are matching correctly, right? If they're associated and they are generated from the same source, I will know that, yes, this is a secured user. Now this, the key that we're talking about is part of your browser, could be part of the application, which is any other application which is installed on that device, on that machine. Another approach over here is the hashing algorithm, right? So using this hashing algorithm, users can protect the information. If they are retrieving this information, retrieving these details, it will be easier for them to work with. But only person who knows the hashing algorithm or who has that algorithm with them, they can decrypt that information or they can generate original text from the hashed content. Right? This is a core purpose of hashing and one of the mechanisms of securing your solution, securing the resources. Moving further, let's look at identity concepts over here. Now, after specifying all these details, the first question that will come to your mind is, Om Prakash, thanks for mentioning all these things about security. Right? Or somebody would say, no thanks, this is the generic information available all over the internet. I have already implemented some of these details. Correct? But if you want to actually implement this or go into details of this, how do you do that? One of the important members which will help you doing that will be your authentication system. In your on-premises environment, from last 20, 25 years, we have been using solutions given by Active Directory. And once it comes to Active Directory is a much more sophisticated kind of environment, but it also depends upon how many of those features we are using. What do I mean by that? In Active Directory, you have services like Active Directory Domain Services, ADDS. You have Active Directory Certificate Services, ADCS. I have Active Directory Rights Management Services, which is ADRMS. I have Active Directory Lightweight Directory Services, ADLDS. Anything I missed out? Yeah. Active Directory Federation Services, ADFS. So each of these services will have different set of roles to play. Most common thing that we have been using at times, most common thing that we have been using is ADDS, which is Active Directory Domain Services. Apart from that, there are many other services that we are not even aware about, and we don't even think about it, right? Which are definitely critical for us. So people are very commonly using ADDS, people are very commonly using ADFS, Active Directory Federation Services. Just give me a moment. I close that link. There are a few questions which I should take up. I'll come to this a bit later. Swaroop, I'm sorry, I can't share these slides because these are all MCT material. Manish and Rupesh will share you the entire recording. Mainak has a question. Can we exact technical controls? I'm sorry, Mainak, I'm not aware about the exact question, but I can share.
The question is about an exact place or a placeholder. Where can you get to know the exact technical controls or organizational measures that has been implemented as a part CIA, confidentiality, integrity and availability, from Azure side?
So here, what I can help you with is, there is something called as Microsoft Trust Center. Maximum amount of details, which is in context of this paper. And apart from this, any other information that people are interested in from security perspective, you'll be able to get all details over here in terms of privacy, data management, GDPR compliance, or compliance specific details, which I was talking about. So you all will be able to get that information from here. Microsoft Trust Center is applicable for Microsoft 365, Office 365, and any other Microsoft services that we have. If you're looking for more specifics in terms of which services are relevant for which areas, covered as part of the sessions.
Sessions only, okay.
Yes.
Because I believe this Trust Center documentation is quite exhaustive, actually. Once I went through, and to find out the exact answers, if you get some questions around, say, confidentiality controls, encryption mechanisms, which you explained already as symmetric and asymmetric and all. I have it here.
Service assurance, encryption and decryption, key management, data center security. So I know it is exhaustive, but areas, which is your focus area, go there.
Okay.
Like identity and access management. If you're looking at something like Sentinel, check for incident management.
Incident. So incident management has the SIEM also there, solutions
yes,
for Microsoft.
Yes, absolutely. You have okay. Sentinel. Azure Sentinel is a solution for incident management.
Incident management, okay. That's really nice. I'll go through it, Om. Yeah, let me go through it. Yeah.
Let's proceed ahead. So I was talking about some of the core services of Active Directory, right? Five services: ADDS, ADCS, ADFS, ADRMS, and ADLDS. These are five core services within Active Directory. If you look at specific, if I want to get into more details of Active Directory, this itself is a 5 to 10 day session, and there is a specialized certification on this as well. It's that deep, right? Like I said earlier, in our case, we are looking at just two members right now. One is ADDS and ADFS. Now, both these members, both these core components are being implemented on your Azure environment by using Azure Active Directory, right? So using Azure Active Directory, which is a service being hosted on Azure platform, you can get all the required resources over here. Now, using these Active Directory resources, using Azure Active Directory services, using the integration of both these members, what we can do is we can protect from password-based attacks. We can protect our environment from phishing attacks or spear phishing. If you look at securing the primary security parameter, so I can have identity for the partners and customers using Azure Active Directory B2B for partners and Azure Active Directory B2C for customers when they are connecting to my application. As far as employees are concerned, I already mentioned about that. As far as devices are concerned, here we have endpoint protection solutions given by Microsoft. If you're looking at device management solution, device management solution would be Microsoft Intune, which will help you to control those resources. So earlier we had SCCM. Now we have Microsoft Intune, which will help you protect your devices and manage the devices. In terms of on-premises applications, I can use a hybrid identity over here, which will help me connect and secure my on-premises apps. I can have number of cloud applications. So these cloud applications can be registered inside my Azure Active Directory, and I can give permissions to my cloud app over here, right? So I can use something called as managed identity. I can use something called as service principal. Now, how these things should be created and managed, those details we provide as part of our sessions. So if you look at the core pillars that we mentioned earlier, administration, I already mentioned about authentication. As far as authorization is concerned, I mentioned about that as well. The point which I did not mention about is auditing. Now, what is this auditing all about? So Manish requested that I want to access some financial details because I want to generate a report and share it with the put it onto Facebook or Twitter so that it becomes easier for people to see how many sessions we have done on each technologies. Correct? Within internal team, I would want to generate a report of how much revenue we have done on each technologies. Right? Some kind of report that he needs to create for marketing purposes. So I've given him that permissions. As an administrator, I have authorized him to access some of the contents. Right? By doing the auditing, I would be able to figure out that he's accessing the same information that he has asked for, or he's accessing some other details as well. Correct? Now that is what is called as auditing process. So once it comes to authentication and authorization, this is a normal day-to-day process. But once it comes to privileged identity management, what I would do is I would want to promote him. I would want to promote him, assign some higher roles for that particular time period, which is 2 hours, 3 hours, whichever time, whatever time is required for him to generate that report or access that information, right? So I have given him that information. I have eliminated permissions for him for that particular time frame, and I want to check whether he has done those tasks or he has accessed some other unwanted information. Now that details will come as part of auditing, right? So there will be a complete report of what contents was being accessed by Manish, and if he has accessed something else, he has to justify himself. Why did he do that? Or why is that information required? So if you look at the modern authentication process, just saying Azure Active Directory does everything. So the common question here would be, Om Prakash, what does Azure Active Directory do? And what is there behind the scene which it happens? So here, if you see, the major authentication process which is happening behind the scene is by creating identities for users, devices, applications. There are three fundamental entities or fundamental elements that you have over here. If you look at your identity providers, they will give you three services that we spoke about in the previous slide, right? It also allows users to specify appropriate policies over here, authentication policies, authorization policies. If you look at your Azure B2C, there you have complete set of custom policies that we can define using XML. You can define the user flows, which user, how will it connect, what will happen next. So all that information is being provided over here. We can check for monitoring, we can check for user behavior, right? We can check for all those details by using the reports, audit reports which has been generated. Another important principle that you'll see is single sign-on. See, as a user, I would hate if I have to log in multiple times whenever I open up a browser instance or whenever I go to the new application instance, right? So once this is being done, once my user ID and password is being done, once I have the token being associated, I should be allowed to use the same user ID and password. I should be allowed to use the same credentials in number of areas, whether it is on-premises applications, on-premises resources, whether it is cloud-based environment, whether it is SaaS applications, PaaS applications, right? So I would want to use the same set of services, same set of credentials at number of places, right? So I don't have to enter the credentials again and again. If you look at your Microsoft Azure Active Directory, which I was mentioning about, it's a cloud-based identity provider, which helps you with all these features that we are talking about. Along with this, I also mentioned about federated authentication, federated services by using ADFS. Similar to ADFS on cloud environment, you have something called as Azure B2B. Azure Active Directory B2B services, this will help you to federate with number of other with people coming from different set of domains. And for these users, for these guest users, we can give them appropriate permissions saying that you have access on a virtual machine, you could have access, read access on a storage account, right? Now, why is that required? Okay, so when y'all are going to your end customers, right? Y'all are not employees of that organization. Y'all are guests over there, right? So as a consultant, when you are providing your services over there, you have to be given an appropriate identity. You need to be given a specific access to a resource so that you can perform your tasks in that given timeline. Correct? That is the reason for federation. Even if you are a part of an organization and you want your other partner organizations to access information from your platform or your environment, you will have to add them as a guest user, correct? So that they can access the contents, they can generate reports or perform tasks which they are assigned for, and they can give you a final outcome of the same, right? So here, what you need to check for is you need to establish something called as Azure B2B. Establish a trust relationship between both the members. If you look at your domain services over here, your domain services will help you provide the complete hierarchy, and that's what is referred as Active Directory Forest, right? So you have entire branching over here from top to bottom, where all the applications are being registered, all the users are being registered, right? Other relevant resources that we have within our on-prem environment, those are being registered over here, right? Any devices like printers, scanners, even those can be associated. So all these members are being given a specific identity so that they can be discovered, they can be accessed by other members, and we should be able to utilize it effectively. Right? So that's the core purpose of why we need to register these resources into Active Directory. Okay. So as part of this first module that we have discussed today, in the time frame that we had, was understanding about the Zero Trust model, what are the options available over here, where we discussed about how nobody can be trusted, how your identities have to be created, registered, and we'll have to use these members over here. We mentioned about the shared responsibility model in context of on-prem environment, where everything has to be taken care of by the customer. We discussed about infrastructure as a service. We discussed about platform as a service, and we discussed about software as a service. And on each level, how the shared responsibility model changes, how we are also responsible for certain aspects like information protection, data protection, right? We are responsible for controlling things on different kind of service provisions like network applications. Then we discussed about the CIA triad, and I mentioned about how Microsoft Trust Center can provide you more information about each of these services and ensure that you are able to you are making your environment accessible even after providing all these details, even after enforcing so many security principles. Then we discussed about the common cybersecurity threats for business and personal data, right? Then we have looked at security parameters and the pillars of identity. As part of this identity management solution that you have, we time and again mentioned about Azure Active Directory. To showcase that, go to aadportal.com. Just give me a moment. Okay, I'm not going to Office 365, nor I'm going to Azure portal. The reason being, people should be able to understand that Azure Active Directory is a separate service altogether, right? It also has its own portal. So this is a portal for Azure Active Directory, azureactivedirectory.portal.azure.com, right? So here, if you check for resources, you have mechanisms of creating number of users. You want to invite a guest user. We invite Manish. Manish@hotmail.com. accept invitation for Azure B2B. I can add a personal message over here. I can assign him whatever role I want. He can invite other colleagues over here. So I can make him guest inviter. I can make him help desk administrator. Reports reader. So I can give him specific roles, and with these roles, he will also get set of permissions. Location. Job title. Marketing expert. Department. Marketing. Name Synergetics. I'm not mentioning any manager over here. Let me send an invite. Right. So Manish will receive an email. I can grant this role later, not a problem. So now he has to accept this invite. Once he accepts the invite, I can assign permissions to him. I can assign appropriate roles to him. Okay. I can assign a role to him. Right. So if you see this process, so here I can say he's permanently eligible, or he's eligible for a specific period of time. I can mention the date time over here. I can assign him a specific time duration for completing his tasks. And if you'll see this, Manish is not part of my organization. He's a consultant. He's an independent marketing consultant. So I have added him as a guest user. And you see this? So user type as guest user. Other user types that you see are, these are the members. These are members within the same organization. Apart from this, you'll see AD user one. He's a synchronized user. AD user one. Every other user is a member, whether from on-premises or whether from the current one. Whereas Manish underscore Hotmail, this is a guest user. Getting everyone? So this is the core mechanism of how you can go ahead and create these resources or work with these members. When you have large number of users over here, you can put them into a specific group. This is more in terms of managing these, simplifying the management of resources. So I can go to security admins as a group, which I have created, and I can add Manish over here. So all the rights or permissions which is being assigned to this particular group, which is called as security admins, will be assigned to Manish as well. Okay. Third one that you see is external identities. So for external identities, you can create your flow over here. So for external identities, you can create your respective flow over here. So which identity provider you want to associate? Google, Facebook, SAML. You can mention that. Right. So you have set of external collaboration settings that you can mention here. Now all these things are part of your external identity verification, external identity creation within your Azure Active Directory. If you want to see what are the other roles and what are the permissions of these roles, if you want to create a custom role over here, you can perform it over here. Right? I was mentioning about enterprise applications. You'll see there are a lot of pre-existing applications which are being added over here. There are more than 2000 and above applications which are pre-registered over here. So if you have your service, you can go and add those components over here. You can add your applications here. Obviously, you need to have a subscription for that as well. Just doing an application association is not sufficient. You need to have a license, or you need to have your subscription on these services. Then you can go and associate that within your Azure AD. Okay. So the actual mechanism of how do you create applications, how do you register over here, how do you associate and work with properties like conditional access, privileged identity management. So all these points will cover or will get covered as part of the session once it comes to your SC900. Okay, so that's all from my side. I hand over to Rupesh. Rupesh, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All yours.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much, sir, for this session on Microsoft Compliance Solutions webinar, SC900 certification. Everyone, please pay attention here. I'm just sharing my screen for a moment. Few announcement I want to quickly make. One second. So I hope my screen is visible to you all.
Yeah, yes, it's visible.
Okay, so as I said at the start of the session, this is our upcoming webinar calendar. The next webinar that is happening for ETT, that is Emerging Technology, the topic is Jakarta EE9 specifications. So the date of this webinar is 21st of August. You all can register for this webinar. We have already shared the link, but yeah, once again, we are sharing it for you. So the next certification webinar is happening on 4th of September in the afternoon, 2:30 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. The topic is DP900 certification. Once again, the special announcement for the day, as I've said, your feedbacks are very important to us. So do share the feedbacks, and based on those submitted feedbacks, we are going to select 5 lucky winners who are going to get the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers. Another special announcement, there's a special campaign that is conducted by Microsoft where it is related to your LinkedIn profile. So once you have attended this session, so you can just update your skills on your profile. And once the account is updated, you can submit your entry. We'll be sharing you the link. The link is available in the feedback form. at the bottom of the form. And also you can update your certifications if you have done any in the past few months. So you can update your account and just fill the entry form. One lucky winner could win Microsoft Surface laptop every month. So do enroll for this campaign. You can follow us on all the social media platforms for the timely updates about our future announcements, technology updates, recent blogs, all the content we share on the social media channels. Also for the recording, you can follow our YouTube channel. We'll be sharing the recording soon. So we'll share the YouTube channel link in the chat box. Thank you so much once again for attending this session. We'll see in the next webinar. We'll meet in the next webinar. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
I'll share all the links. Please do check that.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for the session.
Thanks for the session, no, Prakash. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've shared all the links. Please do check them. Thank you.